Good evening. Well, this is it, the penultimate Sunday of the year, and our readings place us square in the middle of something that I think is at least fascinating or of interest to many, many people: the end of the world. When you hear the gospel tonight, you probably scratch your head and said, "Now, Jesus, what's that supposed to mean?" When Father Dan looked at the readings this week, he scratched his head, and I said, "Now, what's that supposed to mean?" Of course, the church has thought long and hard about these readings and about the end of the world, and has much to say in 2,000 years of rich tradition. It's a topic that's also very confusing. There's a lot of misconceptions, and it's easy to misinterpret. So hopefully tonight it'll all make a little bit more sense for us. I think it's easy to get caught off guard by what Jesus says in the scriptures. Thus, as we listen to the scriptures at Mass and we read them by ourselves, I think it's helpful, especially with these kind of passages, to bear a few things in mind. First, our gospel tonight is what is called Jesus' eschatological discourse. That's fancy talk for his speech about the end of the world. And he does it in a particular way. When we as Catholics read the scriptures, we read it always in a particular way. We read it in context. It's kind of like if you don't read a book that's fiction as if it was something that really happened. Fairy tale, like it's a news report. You don't read a drama like it's an academic treatise. And you don't take a poem literally. That's really important if you want to get the right message out of the right kind of story or literature that you read. And it's the same for these kind of readings in the gospel, what's known as apocalyptic literature. In fact, this gospel, chapter 13 of Mark's gospel, sometimes called the Little Apocalypse, it speaks about the end of the world and what will happen, but it's mysterious and symbolic, like the book of Daniel and the book of Revelation. And they're not meant to be taken literally. Rather than frighten us, which sometimes can happen if we don't read it in context, it's meant to console those people who have faith and to prepare us for the challenges we face during our lifetime, because our consolation and our hope is in the words of Jesus, which do not pass away. It gives us hope because, like I said to the little kids, in the end, Jesus wins. There's a happy ending. I think another thing to bear in mind when we have passages like this is that Jesus is talking to his friends and to his Jewish world about the destruction of the temple in Jerusalem. And for Jews in that time of history, the temple is cosmic. It brings together everything in the whole world. And for the Jews, the destruction of the temple and the end of the world are one and the same. They can't be separated. And so when Jesus says that all these things will take place before this generation passes away, he's pointing to the fact that within 40 years, easily within a lifetime, Jerusalem and its temple would be destroyed by the Romans. We know that obviously the world didn't end. We're still sitting here. But for us, this church building is symbolic, and we're going to learn about that tonight and come to the table, all the different things and aspects of a church and what do they mean. But it's what happens inside of this space, the worship of God in spirit and truth, which is truly cosmic, which does not pass away. Tonight, to come to the table, we'll talk about the liturgy that we celebrate, the signs and the symbols, and the design of early Christian churches, those things that are reflected in architecture, the fact that churches were built facing east, for example, the direction of the rising sun as we await the second coming of Jesus with joyful hope and anticipation. Tonight you'll learn about the inclusion of art and architecture, which is a cosmic design. It points to where we're going in heaven. There's so much in our Catholic tradition, so it's a beautiful theme to explore this year and come to the table. It all points to the fact that for us as Catholics, liturgy, what we do in here every Sunday, plug in to the cosmic action of God. You have a front row seat, brothers and sisters, with all the angels and saints in heaven, all those who have ever lived throughout history, in every place, in every time. Here, we are united to heaven, what doesn't pass away. Here, we're united, we're with Jesus in the upper room, in the foot of the cross. Here, we're united at every Mass, to every Mass that has ever been celebrated in 2,000 years. Think about that. I don't know anything that's more cosmic. Here, in a sense, is a little appetizer for the kingdom of heaven. The very heavenly presence of God in Holy Eucharist that comes into our lives. Today's readings that focus us on the second coming of Christ, when he will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. That's what we profess every Sunday. And that coming is mysterious and cosmic. When it happens, Jesus says in the reading today that all creation, everyone, everything will know who Jesus is when he comes in his glory. Not like the first time when he was a little baby, it was hard to recognize he was God. That's a great consolation to a church that's persecuted, like the people to whom St. Mark is writing, that everybody will know who Jesus is. It's a great and beautiful consolation to us. What a beautiful thing it will be when everyone will recognize Jesus, who he really is. When we will see him in radiant glory, we'll see him as he is. Eye has not seen and ear has not heard what God has prepared for those who love him, it says in the scriptures. We'll see him in his glory. We'll see our own sins. We'll see our own lives. Those of our brothers and sisters as well. All will be all in all. We'll be judged, held accountable, and spend eternity accordingly. The prophet Daniel says, though, that the wise in faith, the wise in God, will shine brightly like the stars forever. Thus, even now, like the stars, our lives must reflect the sun, should reflect who Jesus really is. In his radiant glory. Do our lives reflect Jesus? Do our choices reflect him? Would others recognize Jesus in the way we go about our daily lives? Have we done this to the least of these, knowing that we do it to Jesus? Each Sunday we say that I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. The coming of Jesus is not something we should be afraid of. It's something that we should look forward to, where there will be justice and peace. And in the news, there's so much violence this week. No more violence, no more killing, no more death, but peace. When God reigns, when wrong is made right, when all of our beloved dead will rise in Christ, and we will be united with him and with them. Something really to look forward to and not to fear. Ultimately, Jesus says the destruction of Jerusalem will happen soon, but he says that nobody knows the time or the hour when the world will come to an end. Not even the Son, only the Father. Thus, I think the message for us is to be vigilant. Nobody knows. Take away from the gospel is we're reminded to be vigilant in the way that we lead our lives, that we read the signs of the times, the working of the Holy Spirit in our hearts, in our communities, in our families, in our brothers and sisters, in our world, and prepare ourselves to meet Jesus by the way that we live. Wherever there is darkness, to bring his light. Jesus invites us not to wait to start treating each other as we would want to be treated, not to wait to show his love and his mercy, not to wait to grow in patience and forgiveness and to turn from sin in our lives, whatever form it takes. Let us really look forward to the coming of Jesus by the way that we welcome him into our homes, into our hearts, into our families, and even here and now, as we receive him in Holy Communion. The early Christians, whom we'll learn about tonight, built their churches and established their houses of worship so that they might anticipate the kingdom of heaven, even here and now, and support one another on their journey to the kingdom of heaven. May we be inspired by their example and strengthened by the same sacraments they received, and by our brothers and sisters, that we might do